A very good morning to all of you. Right. First of all, I'd like to thank Prof. Karim for inviting me to USM. Right. And this is actually giving me another excuse to balik kampung. All right. I'm from Penang. All right. I'm from Penang. And basically today, I would like to share with you some success stories. All right. And also to share with you also the various innovations that we have implemented at Taylor's University. All right. And with the purpose to bring e-learning closer to our academics, and also to make our academics to implement various e-learning activities in a more meaningful way. Right? I'm Lim. I'm from the Intellect at Taylor's. Intellect is actually equivalent to CDAE in USM. All right. Intellect stands for Integrated Teaching and Lifelong Learning Center at Taylor's. Right. Under our Intellect, we have four different units. All right. Different units focusing on different areas. All right. And my department is actually e-learning academy. All right. E-learning academy is actually a department that brings various innovations to the universities. Later, I'm going to share with you a few projects also. All right. And also, the department was set up in 2012. All right. With the specific mandate to drive and support the e-learning implementations for the entire universities. All right. We are actually a very young universities. All right. Last month only we celebrated our fourth anniversary uni. All right. It's actually a very young university. We have around 600 academics. All right. 600 academics. We have 13 different schools. All right. 13 different schools. And I was from the business school. All right. I was from the business school, and then now I was transferred to this teaching and learning center. Right. Teacher and learning center here. Okay, all right. I would like to make these sessions as interactive as possible, and I would like y'all to. You see, in the traditional classrooms, right, the first thing before the teacher start the class is the teacher is going to ask all of you to switch off your phone, right? And now I would like to make it different. I would like y'all to take out your phone. All right, could you please take out your phone? All right, take out your phone and make sure your phone is connected to the Wi-Fi. Take out your phone and make sure your phone is connected to the Wi-Fi. Could we do it together? All right. So all our Q&A sessions will be using this platform. Right? They are all together three different steps you need to follow. Step number one is, once you are connected to the Wi-Fi, can you please go to the internet browser on your phone? Just go to internet browser on your phone. Let me show you here. Let's say I'm going to Safari. Number two, open a new tab. All right, open a new tab and type Today's Meet, T-O-D-A-Y-S, todaysmeet.com and / USM, USM. Just type todaysmeet.com / USM and click Enter. Once you click Enter, you should be able to come to this page. And the next thing you need to do is just to type your nickname. All right, just type your name here. Now just type your name and click Join. So I'm going to type my name here, Lim, all right, and you, I can just put Taylor's, all right, Lim Taylor's, and click Join. And the next thing is just type a short message to say hi to everybody. Just say hi. Yep. Okay, I'm able to see some. Oh yeah, Sue, GB, all right. Yeah. So just say hi to everybody. Yeah, Prof. Karim, all right. Dr. Rehana, Prof. Hanafi, okay. So later, all the Q&A sessions we are going to base on here. And I really don't mind if you interrupt me, all right, during my presentation also. All right, feel free to interrupt me during my presentation by posting the questions here. And on and off, I'm going to back to this platform to see whether you have any questions for me or not. And this is one of the systems, we call this as an audience response system that we used. All right, it's commonly used in Taylor's. All right, we use it during lectures, all right, to interact with our students, especially in a big lecture theater. And in a big lecture theater, the first thing I'm going to ask my students to do is, when they come to lecture theater, they'll take out their device, and then this is one of the ways so-called we take attendance. All right, this is one of the ways we take attendance. We are not going to pass attendance around to take attendance. We use this platform. All right, so I'm going to ask one simple question for them. All right. And I would like them to actually put it their real name if they say they want me to take their attendance. All right, so today's session, no attendance is required. All right, so we are going to just use this as a platform for us to interact. All right, I hope more and more people will come and join us. Let me repeat the steps again. All right, let me repeat the steps again. They are all together. Four different steps. Number one, click on your internet browser on your phone. I think nowadays, our students, this generation Y students, right, they are easily connected to mobile devices. You agree, right? We don't ask them, do you have mobile devices? But we ask them, how many mobile devices you have? They are connected to multiple mobile devices now, right? And we try to make use of the technologies, all right, to engage them, to make learning more relevant to them. Right? Make learning more relevant to them, make learning fun to them also. I think generation-wise, they would like to actually voice up their opinion. All right? If you ask them to stand up and talk, I don't think they want. All right? So this is one of the ways for us to actually promote and also encourage them to talk. Okay, all right. Let's start with this. My topic for the sharing today is basically to educate, let's innovate. All right? Innovations can be done in many different ways, but today I'm going to focus on how to actually make use of technology in classrooms, all right, to promote a few things. Number one is we like our students to become more self-directed learners. All right, how to make them become a self-directed learners with the help of technology. Number two, we want them to provide them a more personalized way of learning, all right, to make learning more personalized to them. And also because we believe they know how they can learn best. All right, so I'm going to give you different types of technologies and you decide how you're going to learn best. And one of the technologies later I'm going to go into slightly more detail will be our lecture capture systems, which I think is quite relevant to USM also. All right, lecture capture systems, and I'm going to share with you some sad stories as well as some success stories also. All right. Yeah, and let's start with this. Let's start with this one. Let me give you an intro of my department, all right, give you an intro of the department and also the e-learning mission of the universities that we like to achieve. We always share this with our lecturers also because we want them to understand that all the e-learning activities that we are implementing at the university level is actually to help our students, all right. It's not to make the lecturer's life more difficult, all right. I know, I think all of us, right, if let's say a camera is focusing on you, you don't feel comfortable. All right, you don't feel comfortable. But if let's say this is actually good for our students, so that our students can actually do revision with this lecture capture, then I think the buy-in would be more positive from the lecturers also. All right. So in this presentation, basically, I'm going to share with you about the introduction of blended learning. All right. In Taylor's, blended learning, e-learning is actually similar. All right. We call this blended learning because blended learning is actually to use technologies to enhance the face-to-face interaction. We still remain face-to-face interaction. All right, still remain face-to-face interaction, but we use technologies to enhance the face-to-face interaction. All right, and let me share with you one video. Can I have the volume to on?
First step towards achieving this goal.
It all began on April 2011, when Taylor's University officially approved a five-year e-learning strategic plan. As the first step towards achieving this goal, a new unit within Interact was born. It's the e-learning academy. We're working towards a brighter future built on the philosophy that technology can improve education. ELA is committed to explore and work harder to provide academics and students at Taylor's University with a new and effective way of teaching and learning. Let's work together to bring a meaningful change in transforming our students' learning experience through the effective implementation of blended learning activities. We strongly believe that by 2016, every student at Taylor's University will learn in a collaborative, self-directed, and personalized manner, anytime and anywhere.
As mentioned in the video, we have three main objectives to achieve. All right. Number one is we would like our students to be able to learn in a more collaborative manner. Right? To learn in a more collaborative manner. That's why later I'm going to share with you how we have transformed the classrooms, how we have transformed the traditional classrooms into a, we call this as a collaborative classrooms, a future classrooms. Number two is how to provide students a more personalized way of learning by installing the lecture capture systems in all the lecture theaters. Right. And also the third part is how we actually make use of the learning management systems. Right. Learning management systems. At Taylor's, we are using Moodle. I believe USM, you all are using Moodle, right? Yeah, we are using Moodle. Right. We are using Moodle as an e-learning platform. It's our official e-learning platform to implement different types of e-learning activity for our students also. So these are the three different parts I'm going to share with you later. So number one is the lecture capture systems. All right. We call this as Rewind. Right. Just for a branding purpose, we call this as Rewind. So you ask students, do you know lecture capture system? They say, what is lecture capture? But you ask them, do you use Rewind or not? All of them say, yes, we are using Rewind. Right? They know this as Rewind. Right? Number two is, we call our new classrooms as the X-Space classrooms. X-Space classrooms. X stands for to experience a new way of learning. All right? To experiment a new way of teaching also for our academics. Right, it's a classroom. Basically, it's a classroom. Right? It's a classroom that promotes collaborative learning. And the last part will be our learning management systems. Right, our Moodle. But at Taylor's, we don't call this as Moodle. All students call this as TIMES. TIMES stands for Taylor's Integrated Moodle E-Learning Systems. The M stands for Moodle. Right, it's TIMES, Taylor's Integrated Moodle E-Learning Systems. It's our official e-learning platform. Right, it's our official e-learning platform that we use, all right, to transform the traditional classrooms into a more interactive interactive learning environment. And we strongly believe that learning is not only within the classrooms, learning should be anytime and anywhere with the help of technologies also. Okay, all right. Let me go back to my today's meet. All right, And I would like to, let me check with you. Would you be able to share with me one simple task, one simple innovation that you have tried before? One e-learning activities that you have implemented before in your class?
Using Padlet.com.
Padlet.com, yes, all right. Dr. Rahana mentioned Padlet.com. Are you familiar with Padlet.com? Padlet.com also is actually a wall, right? It's actually a virtual wall where students are able to post message. Yeah, so Padlet.com is one of the platform we use also. We call this, normally we use it for case study. Padlet, P-A-D-L-E-T, Padlet.com. Using tweeters, all right, using tweeters in the classrooms, yeah. Something students are very familiar with, using Twitter in the classrooms. What other different e-learning activities you have tried before?
Landspace.
Sorry?
Landspace.
What is this? It's
Blankspace.com.
It's a canvas where you can post.
It will be very similar to Padlet, though. So yeah, thanks. Okay, there are so many different types of the platform available. All right, and some mention a Facebook group. Yeah, I think Facebook is something that very common. All right, Pool everywhere. All right, All right, so that you can actually interact with students. All right, something like Socrative. Right, student response systems, audience response systems. Yep. All these are little innovations. Thanks, all right, using Google Doc for group discussions. Right? Yeah, Google Docs for group discussions. Any other innovations? Why none of you talk about lecture capture systems? Right? Okay, all right. The first thing I would like to share with you will be our lecture capture systems. Right? The lecture capture systems. The purpose of this lecture capture system is to promote self-directed and more personalized learning experience to our students. Right, we started this lecture capture system in 2012. Right, 2012, and last year I met Prof. Anafi. All right, anyway, I actually shared my experience with him also. All right, about this lecture capture systems. Let me share with you some sad story first. All right, some sad stories about these lecture capture systems. We face a lot of challenges. I face a lot of challenges when to implement these lecture capture systems. Number one is, I believe lecturers are not comfortable. All right, once they enter to this lecture theater, they notice there's one camera, and this camera is actually a smart camera that can follow you. And so I walk here, the camera will follow me here also. All right, and then and then lecturers are not comfortable, and then lecturers say, okay, so meaning if I late for my class, then my deans will know. All right, because everything is recorded. All right, and So this is number one. All right. Number two is we give options for the lecturers also. All right. When we started this also, we give options to the lecturers. You have the flexibility, all right, to start recording and end the recording. And then after the recording, you can decide whether you want to publish the you want to publish the recorded videos or not. Then we try for about 2 months. We noticed the usage is very low. Less than 3% of the whole Taylor's community actually publish their own video. All right, and then we discussed how can we actually promote this lecture capture, because universities really invested a lot in these lecture capture systems. Then we started with this, we call this REC, record that, it's Rewind Engagement Corner. Rewind Engagement Corner. We go to each of the school and then tell the lecturers about the purpose of these lecture capture systems. We interview students, all right, to ask students to tell the lecturers what are the benefits of these lecture capture systems to them, all right, and then how this lecture capture system help them to manage the students' time better, all right, because I think our students, they are very active in a lot of activities, all right. Sometimes they just need to skip your class because of other activities. Right, and this lecture capture system is one of the way to actually help them to do revision. And we also start promoting this lecture capture system to our lecturers also. And lecturers, before a student come and see us, example, let's say I'm teaching a subject, before students come and see my come and see me during my consultation, the first thing I'm going to ask him or her will be, have you watched my lecture capture or not? If they say yes, then which part you don't understand? I need the time. Right, so students tell you, okay, sir, actually, last week your lectures, from this time to this time, I don't understand it. Right, because we would like them to actually to build a habit, all right, and this is what we have learned from students also. Students nowadays, they tell us, sir, I come to your class, I'm not copying down the notes. What do I copy down? They copy down the time. So if let's say now, I'm actually talking something very important by exam, they just write down, now is 11:45. Right, they just look at 11:45 and this is the time that they don't understand, and according to our statistics also, these are our statistics. We publish these statistics every month to the entire community to show to them that we actually appreciate your support in these lecture capture systems. And like every month we're going to, this year compared to last year, we are able to see about increase 74% in terms of the number of recording. All right. We are able to see in terms of our number of views, increased 48%, and started this February 2014, we allow our students to download the whole video. We allow them to download the whole video. All right. That's why you're able to see downloads also. We allow them to download the whole videos, and students actually spend about 19,000 hours in watching the video. 19,000 hours is actually a lot, right? And we believe that lecture capture system is the easiest, fastest, and also is the most effective ways of creating content. Compared to like one to produce a courseware. This one is very simple. As a lecturer, I just enter to the hall. I just need to teach. Of course, I need to use a mic. When we started these lecture capture systems, a lot of lecturers, they refuse to use the mic. They say, without using mic, my students are able to hear me. All right, but then we start receiving so-called complaints from students saying, sir, why your video is a silent movie? And all right, they thought it's the systems, all right, they thought it's the systems. Then we realize that actually the lecturers are not using mic. Then who am I to ask your lecturers to use a mic? The best person to ask the lecturers to use a mic is? It's the students. All right, students say, sir, can you use the mic or not? Because we really want to watch your recorded lectures. Right, so we actually ask our students to be our ambassadors. All right, our students will be our ambassadors. All right, we also started providing some editing services to our lecturers. All right, so if you don't feel comfortable for your whole entire lectures to be recorded, all right, maybe a certain part you want us to do some trimming for you or not. All right, yes, all right. Beginning, we received some requests from lecturers, but after about 1 year of implementation, lecturers start ignore about this lecture capture already. I don't care lah. All right, as long as students are able to watch this, I'm all right. And according to our statistics also, this lecture capture system normally is 2 hours lectures. Right, 2 hours lectures. How long do you think the students will watch this lecture capture? Remember, this is not a Korean drama. If it's a Korean drama, 2 hours, maybe the students are going to watch twice. Right, 4 hours they're going to watch. But this one, the 2 hours lectures capture, they normally watch about between about slightly more than 10 minutes. All right, it's about 18 minutes. Right, 18 minutes, and this is something very, I'll say it's something very common, because they are not going to watch your entire lectures, they just watch the part they don't understand. Right? They just watch the part that they don't understand, Sony. Right? So we share all these things with our lecturers, and we start getting buy-in. Right? Starting getting buy-in to them also. All right? We share a lot. All these are different schools. We want to create some internal competition among the schools also. Right, to see whether your lecturers are using it. So we share, like, let's say TBS actually stands for Taylor's Business School. See, all right, Taylor's Business School, last month, we have how many recordings, how many students actually watch this, and then how long they actually spend. Right? We do some sharing, right? We even go into very detail about these are the top 10 modules. Right? These are the top 10 modules that actually make use of these lecture capture systems. And I think this is the data for last month. This is the data for last month compared to the same period the year before. We share all these things with lecturers also. And we get some students' testimonial. Right? Get some students' testimonial. And then the main purpose is to tell the lecturers, we are not actually recording you. All right? We are not actually monitoring you. This is only for you and your students only. Nobody can watch this video except you and your students. And your students must be registered in the course. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah.
Can I ask
one? Yes, yeah. You have any questions to ask me?
Yes,
feel free.
I'm asking about the escalation. Because once you allow the video to be downloaded, right, then is there any issues of sharing the videos publicly on the YouTube or anything? Because once the video can be downloaded, then you lose control of everything. Right? So how do you control it?
Okay, all right. We don't really control it. We don't really control it, all right? Because we believe that even you don't allow students to download the video, nowadays there are so many third-party applications that can allow them to download it. All right? The reason why we want to when we decided want to make this downloadable to students, we also received some questions from the lecturers also. All right, then say, beginning you said this is only for me and my students. Now you allow them to download it. What happened if let's say they upload it? All right, upload it into YouTube. All right, and then our answer to them is, we want them to download it because we believe that a system must be user-friendly enough. Right? If they want to watch this video at home, sometimes their internet connection is not as good as in the campus. Right? So in the campus, if they want to download the whole videos, it's much more faster. Much more faster also. And then we realize that students actually tell us, right, they actually watch this video while waiting for buses. All right, maybe every evening, they say they go to this fitness center. They watch this video when they are doing the exercise. All right? So we don't really stop them from downloading, but we actually make a statement that if, let's say, you misuse these lecture capture systems, then disciplinary actions will be taken against you. All right? So meaning you go and do some funny editing, put it up again in YouTube, then students are not allowed to republish the video. They are not allowed to republish the video, but they are allowed to actually download the videos for their own viewing. Right? How do you address the issue of copyright? We ask our lecturers to highlight all these copyright issues in the recording. Example, now I'm sharing with you one YouTube video. I just need to mention, this video actually I downloaded from YouTube. Right? So instead of asking you to go to YouTube and watch the video, I just download it and let you watch the video. And we can put the source there also. I put the source there. Right? And we believe if this is for pure educational purpose, I don't see any problems. How long did you get your staff to convert this approach? This is our second year. All right, this is our second year already. Now, all the lecturers, as long as they are having their class in lecture theatre, their classes will be automatically recorded based on timetable. Based on timetable. Meaning if, let's say, the timetable knows that today I have a class from 10 to 12, 10 o'clock, the whole system will be activated. So as a lecturer, I just need to walk into the lecture theater, make sure I use the mic, then the whole thing will be recorded ready. We try to minimize the layer of complexity. All right. So lecturers just need to come and teach, and at the end of the lectures, the whole videos will be uploaded immediately. So 12 o'clock students can log on to Moodle, they can watch the whole thing. Right? They can watch the whole thing. Any legal implications if you say something against the... If there are some sensitive issues, all right, then the lecturers ask us, okay, the lecturers have the flexibility to hide the video. Right? Before uploading, the lecturers can just hide the video, and then they come and ask us, okay, this is the part I want to remove it, don't show to my students. I think this is a very exciting topic.
Thank you. Sorry, I don't have a device. Can the lecturers decide whether to give the lecture from home, record by themselves, or do they have to walk into the lecture hall?
We allow both, right? We allow both. This rewind is actually having a live lectures, and then the whole thing will be recorded, and we call this, the other one is called, we call this rewind on the go, meaning it's something like flipped classrooms, right? Meaning the lecturers are allowed to actually record it from home. Record it from home, and then publish it for students to view it before they come to the class. Before they come to the class or so. Right? So yeah, we and this is very popular, especially when lectures go for conferences. Right? The deans will say, if you are able to replace your class with this lecture capture system, you no need to have a physical class replacement. Right? Then we allow that the lecturers to allow the lecturers to go for conferences by replacing the classes using this online mode also. Okay, all right. So these are some of the data. All right, these are some of the data, and I'll share everyone video.
All 20 LTs are now equipped with rewind lecture capture system. Students are now able to view the recorded lectures three times right after the end of the class. Hence, enable them to learn in self-directed and personalized manner, anytime and anywhere. There have been positive reviews on the impact of rewind on students and lectures. The students have reported that rewind allows them to understand better as it allows them to listen to it again and again. The lecturers have reported that rewind increased engagement with students during lecture and allows the visual learners to do revisions by watching video.
We have lecturers also started to recycle their recording. Example, let's say last semester I taught the subjects A, all right, let's say accounting 101, and this semester I'm teaching accounting 101. I'm going to recycle some of the videos last semester. I trim the video and then upload it for students to watch. So in this case, I no need to repeat the same thing, but I'm able to use my lecture times to have more meaningful discussions and engagement with my students. Right. And also, we extend this lecture capture system not only for lectures, we extend it for meeting. For example, let's say you want to have a school meeting, all right, with your deans, and then sometimes you have classes, you are not able to attend the meeting, the whole sessions will be recorded. Those are not able to come for the meeting, they have to watch the video. Right. And last year, we organized a conference, right, organized a conference, a teacher and learning conference, and the whole sessions will be recorded also, and receive a very good feedback from the delegates also. Share with you. See whether I'm able to share with you some. Like last year, right, all these are the sessions, all right, all these are our teacher learning conference, and all the sessions we actually get permission from the presenters. I get permission from presenters to record their sessions, and let me see whether I'm able to see some of the, something like this.
Let me see that internship exposes students.
All right, and then I can jump to.
Okay, in terms of learning beyond the classroom,
so we expand the.
What even is the scope and substantially small part of what the
so we expand the lecture capture system beyond only for teaching.
Also must be understood as the founder.
The reason why we expand all this to different possibilities is because we really need to get a strong support from our management. Right? This is a huge investment and we would like to really make this a success also. And all this are the after 2.5 years of implementation. Yes, I have a question.
I think the previous question about how long did you get the stuff transferred to the system.
Uh-huh.
I think the question is not about the preparations before the classes, the timetable, pen to draft and so on, but how long did you get the whole stuff involved to the convert system.
Okay, all right. How long do we take? We spend the first 6 months by selecting some lecturers from different schools, all right, who really believe that lecture capture is the way to go. All right, we work with these six lecturers only. All right, six lecturers. We only have one venue. All right, when we started this, we only have one venue, and then we put all the six lecturers there. All right, to conduct their entire semester class, and at the end of the class, we do a class evaluation, get feedback, then we share with entire university's community. Then we expand from one venue to 10 venues, right? From one venue to 10 venues, then we start giving options for lecturers. Yes, you want to use it, you can use it. If you don't want, also all right. Then we realize that this is not the way to go. If you give them options at the end, nobody is going to do it. All right. So that's why we put in the systems to make it automated. Make it automated. So as long as your class is here, your whole sessions will be recorded. All right. The whole session will be recorded, and then the lecturers are able to view this. And then from 10 venues, we extend to 22 venues. Right. The whole process takes about 2 years. The whole process takes about 2 years to really get the buy-in from the lecturers. Nowadays, this is very popular. Not only students, lecturers will come and send me an email also and say, next week I'm going to have one important, I'm inviting one speaker to come and make sure the recording is working, because this, I would like my students to watch this. All right, and then we have lecturers also come and tell us, okay, all right, I'm going to do a revision with my students, all right, and this is very important, so can you please make sure the recording is working? All right, so lecturers start seeing the benefits of this already. And of course, the benefits of this is not from their own perspective, it's from the students. All right, how students learn better, right, how students learn better with these lecture capture systems. Right, so to answer you, the whole process takes about 2 years. Right, the whole process really takes about 2 years. That's why when we started this, also only 10 venues, all right, and then after 1 year, we send these communications to the lecturers also. Now, another milestone, all right, we are going to extend to 20 LTs, all right, and then we share with them also how it works also, especially new lecturers, how it works, all right, and then what are the support we give them? I think support is very important, and the most important part is to make the lecturers become believers. I think this is the toughest part, right? To make the lecturers become believers, this is the way to go. Right? Because I think lecturers also sometimes say, you can only learn in my class only, you need to come to my class, there only you learned. All right? I don't think nowadays this is still applicable. Yes, have any? So, this is a very common question. Any issues of attendance or not? When we started this, of course, you are able to see attendance drop. Attendance drop, because students think that they can learn everything by just watching your video. But slowly they realize that if I don't come for your class, right, I watch this 2 hours, because this is not a movie, right? If you want to just watch my 2 hours lectures, you are going to sleep also. All right? So students start realize that they don't really learn much by just watching the video. So they'll start coming to your class. But before this, yes, attendance dropped during lectures, but we are able to see attendance increase in the tutorial. You are able to see more participation in the tutorial, because those who miss your class, they can watch your lectures before they come for a tutorial. So the good thing is more engagement during tutorial class. Right? More in the tutorial class. I think we need to believe that learning is not only physically in the classrooms. Right? Not only physically in the classrooms. We would like them to learn anytime, anywhere. This is one of the...
University is such an exciting place to learn. It is always offering innovative ways to enrich students' learning experience, and one of them is the lecture capture system, or Rewind, an exciting online learning platform. Rewind actually records live lectures and then uploads them in the Peerless integrated Moodle, even for students to view later on. I am very active in extracurricular activities, and sometimes I tend to miss out on important lectures. But right now, I don't have to worry anymore, because I could just go home, open up my computer, and play videos of lectures that I've missed all over again. So to sum it up, I think that Rewind has actually helped me to manage my time better as a student. It also provides me a flexibility so that I could learn and study at my own pace anytime and anywhere.
We produce all these videos, the main purpose is to convince the lecturers. Right, it's actually used to, you know, we use all these videos to convince the lecturers. We go and find some very active students, all right, and then we ask them, how Rewind actually help you? All right, can you do a short video testimonial for us or not? Then we share with the entire community also. So this is what we call this as a Rewind engagement plan. All right, call this a Rewind engagement plan. All right, let me move on. The first part is about lecture capture systems. And lecturers ask us, are you going to install all these lecture capture systems in all the classrooms or not? Our answer is no. Because in the classrooms, we expect you to have more interaction with your students. Lecture theatre is different. Lecture theatre normally is one way, right? So that's why we want to make it to be recorded. But in the classrooms, we try to transform the classrooms, right? From a traditional classrooms into something like this one. We call this an X space, all right, a collaborative classrooms. In these collaborative classrooms, there is no more rows of tables and chairs, but we actually provide five different islands for the students. Right? Again, we always tell our students, you can get 5 A's, 6 A's, but A's only guarantee you for scholarships. We want you to have C's, not A's. The C's are creativity. All right, we want to have. Well, we want to actually promote creativity in the classrooms. What are the C's?
Collaboration.
All right, that's why we want you to actually collaborate with your friends. All right, collaboration. What are the C's? Communication. So we want you to talk in the classrooms. That's why we need to actually transform the classrooms. Collaboration, communications. What are the C's?
Conducive
learning environment. Yeah, you can have many C's that you want. All right. Creativity, all right. This is our classrooms.
Coffee break.
Okay. All right. And do you want to know why we are putting the round table with a glass top? Well, we started this also. This is our fourth generation. It's already fourth generation ready. We keep improving this by getting feedback from lecturers and students. And when we started this fourth generation, lecturers asked us, why are you putting a glass top? Are you going to protect the table? No, we are not going to protect the table. The glass top is for the lecturers and students to write on the table. All right, so as a lecturer, I can just walk around with my marker pen. Anything you don't understand, I can just explain to you on your table. All right, and then students are very excited when you write on the table, because once you have written on the table, they are going to. All right, then they think, I have already learned. All right, so we have a glass top on the table to promote collaboration. All right, we also give them a LCD display. LCD display also for them to work in a group, collaborate, and then share your ideas. So it'll be one student will be sitting and then with their laptop, and then the rest will be actually looking at the big screen at the back. Then we do work together. We do the work together. This is one of the flip classroom model also we are using. All right, and then there are some easy connectivity also. Right. We want to make the classroom as simple as possible. We don't want to build a very complicated, very high-tech classroom. At the end, lecturers take 1 hour to learn. By the time they know how to learn all these things, their class is ready, comes to the end really. So we really make it very simple. Again, our principle is always reduce a layer of complexity. Make it very simple. All right, and then we conduct workshop for the lectures also. All right, how to actually learn in a different way using these collaborative classrooms. And some of the these are some of the photos taken. Do you notice the way the classroom is designed? In these classrooms, all students are BYOD. Bring your own
drink.
Okay, you can bring your own drink to the class. Bring your own device to the class. All right? And we make it, we really want the students to realize that without device, you can't learn. Without device, you can't learn, because everything is actually put it in a cloud already. Right? And lectures are, different groups are doing different work. Right? It's a noisy classrooms concept. We call this noisy classroom concept because we want different groups to do different work. Right? We even allow students, as long as you finish your work, you can leave the classrooms. I'm all right. So that I can focus on other groups which require my attention. Right? This is an overview of the classrooms. Right? In the classrooms, lecturers will walk around and then we explain to them. Right? Explain to them, right? Group by group, and then ask them to do some work. Right? And it's a noisy classrooms, I mentioned. Right? Noisy classrooms, when they need to do a lot of presentation. This is how we build the communication skills. Yes.
The word convincing the lecture several times means that you face problem with the lecture. And that's one thing. The other thing, what about training lecture?
Yes.
Convincing lecture.
Okay, all right. Yeah, I keep emphasizing on convincing lecturers, because I think a lot of lecturers, they are not the believers of all this e-learning.
What about training then?
Training, yes, correct. All this, we conduct at least once every month. We have different types of training. We have training we have trainings. All right. When we started this also, we even invite some professors from Singapore, all right, to come and train us also. All right. How to actually make use of. Because I think the most important training part is how to manage your class if you allow students to actually talk. Classroom management is very important. We don't train lecturers in terms of the content, because we leave lecturers as the content expert, but we train them how to manage their class, how to become a facilitator. We conduct trainings for them. Yes, there is a question at the back.
Yeah, I'm a believer of using technology. your collected data to actually measure whether as a result of all these initiatives, the students are learning better, particularly in the
Yes, this is our plan also. Yeah, manager always asks us, all right, I need data, all right, you don't just talk, all right, you just need, you need to provide us some data. Yes, we collected some data, all right, but at this moment, I'm not able to tell you whether this classroom improved students' results or not. All right, because if you say yes, improved students' results, then the lecturers are going to tell us there are so many other factors, all right. But in terms of students' engagement, in terms of students' communications, yes, it did help a lot, all right, in terms of engagement of students. Yeah, one question, yeah. Yeah.
How do you do it with a large class, 100 over students?
This is only for tutorial.
Okay.
This is only for tutorial. In a large class, we don't. Right? Because in large class, we... This, our tutorial class, is only for 30 students only. Maximum 40 students. In a large class, we provide them lecture capture. In the large class, we provide them lecture capture. We are not able to have this collaborative learning in the large class. Right? And we want them to talk, want them to bring their own devices. Yeah, Prof. Gary?
How many classrooms we have?
Classrooms we have, how many? We have currently, at this moment, we only have 20 classrooms only.
20.
The whole university, we have about 110 classrooms. All right? And so far, we only converted 20 classrooms. Our plan is to convert another 30 next year, slowly. All right? Why are we not converting all the classrooms into X space? Because we want to wait until the lectures are more ready. All right, when you're more ready, then we convert more classrooms for you. Right? And this is actually very challenging also, because we don't want to put all our lectures in these collaborative classrooms, but end up with lectures keep stand in front, keep talking. All right? So this is what we don't want to see. That's why we slowly convert it, all right, face by face. And share with one. Feedback from
so
students
also? This X-Space class is a perfect way to incorporate this technology into our everyday studies. So I think that Taylor is definitely doing the right step by incorporating this and moving to the new frontier.
It's better to conduct classes this way than old school way where students only listen to the lecturer instead of interacting on each
other. I think the classroom design allows students to participate wholeheartedly in the class activities, and the energy they provide is very suitable for the student. They allow students to move around and engage in their cultural activities.
Yeah, I think that actually is a very good experience for me. I have been to such a modern class before, everything is very high tech, surrounded with all kinds of solution. And like doing presentation, I feel the mood, I really have the mood to do the presentation. And I can really boost our confidence. Therefore, I think X-Space is a very good decision for a Taylor to make it here.
I personally think that the X-Space class is interactive and the teaching arrangement is unique, that it's easier for us to do a good discussion. And since the TVs are like connected right to our laptops, so every time we want to do like presentation, it's much easier.
We have our own PowerPoint in the classroom. When we compare to the classroom last time, we don't have to snatch from the classroom, and then we can connect our laptop to the computer. We can share our information with all of our classmates. We don't have to read it out loud to everyone anymore.
Alright, so the second part is basically about classrooms. Alright, second part is basically about classrooms. How we help our students to become a better learner. Alright, in the classrooms. Let me move on. The third part I would like to share with you will be our Moodle. Alright, how we actually promote blended learning through Moodle, through our times. Alright, we believe that learning is not only in the classrooms. Right? We believe that learning is not only in the classrooms, and we will believe that Moodle is a very good platform to increase, number one, learners' interaction, right? in the virtual world, all right? To promote collaboration. Collaboration here not only focus on formal collaboration in the classrooms, we like informal collaboration, and we even want the students to have a virtual learning there also. And the last part is engagement. Engagement here not only focus on my content only. I don't want students to just learn everything from my content. I want them to learn from the third-party content which is easily available online, and also to ask them to build their own content also. Later I'm going to share with some videos. Actually, I ask my students to do a video to explain the concept. Let them learn through their own content also. Right? And some of the activities we We have it here, the Commonwealth will be like e-assessments, right? Online quizzes, online forums, online submissions, all right? To allow learning outside the classrooms, right? To allow learning outside the classrooms, and then to connect them together, right? Connect them together, right? I forgot to mention one thing. We want our students not only to learn from the lecturers, we want them to learn from their peers, and also learn from the world. Learn from the world, right? These are the three dimension, right? Learn from me, learn from your friends, and learn from the world, all right? Through the technologies. Yes, all right, to make it more interactive, right? And this is our times, right? This is our times. We put in some efforts to make it more interactive for our students. We put in some banners for the students also. So if let's say I'm a student from design school, these are subjects I'm going to access to. All right, and then in the subjects, I'm able to see the module outline. I'm able to see the assessments. I'm able to see the resources. Right, and this is a website. So basically, it's a website for them. Right, it's a website for them. And in the website, there are a lot of activities. A lot of activities can be a chat room, can be a forum, can be a blog, can be a lessons, can be a wikis. Right, and these are some of the content we actually work together with the lecturers. Lecturers give us a content, then we develop the content for them, right, to make it more interactive for them. Right? And with this content, we would like to lecturers to minimize teaching in the classrooms. Right? Don't teach so much in the classroom because the content can help you already. What you need to do is you focus on students learning. Right? Focus on student learning instead of keep teaching. Right? And these are some of the activities here, right? The quizzes. Right, to put in some videos, right? To put in some videos, to use some images, attract your students. Okay, all right. And again, we track the usage. We track the usage also. All right, we are going to share. All right, last month, how many students actually access to your times? All right, and then we share with them also how many percent increase in terms of number of clicks. We share with them also compared to last year and this year, whether they do a good job or not, all right? And then we share also different schools, right? Which one is actually our e-learning, right? E-learning pioneer also, right? Share with them also, and these are the top five modules using forum. So now we zoom into detail, all right? If let's say I'm an English lecturer and then at business school, I'm the third, right? In the universities, these are the top five modules using quizzes. These are the top nine subjects most actively using the model, right? So all these are the. We believe communication is very important. Right? We believe communication is very important. Engagement is very important. You can set up the system easily, but if let's say none of the lecturers want to play this game with you at the end, it's quite difficult. All right. So we even ask the lecturers to produce a simple video. Right, and this video will be uploaded into Moodle also. And the purpose of this video is to explain to your students before they take your subjects, right? They want to know what is this subject is all about. All right, so can you produce one simple video for them and let them watch the video? All right, so I can share with some.
What we are attempting to do is to explore identities. Now, one of the most interesting topics ever explored is superheroes and dual identities, duality. And we talk about typology, analogies, archetypes. So in creative thinking, we do a really fun project where we explore different archetypes. And every one of these archetypes have come through a long journey, a long process. They've come through.
And good environment program. A good landscape can create a place where people can live, work, and relax. Through these 18 weeks of this module, you will be able to recognize and identify different types of landscape and its elements. You will be able to explain how.
The purpose of all this video is to help the students understand better the module, especially it's an elective module. So the lecturers will tell them the expectation and to minimize some elements of surprise also. We don't want the students take your subjects again. Huh? You need to do so many different things. Alright, so we let them see the videos and then let them understand it before they register for the subjects. And of course, we are not able to do for all the subjects. We started with foundation. Right? Last year, we started all the foundation courses, and this year, we focus on the year one degree course also. Right? Slowly, we are going to make it slowly to expand it too. This is MOOC. I think this is not something that I think we all are familiar with. All right? But of course, Taylor's MOOC is not really massive. All right? I would say, like Prof. Kari, I watched a video. All right, y'all had the conference, right? And then this M, I think our one should be a mini, all right, instead of massive. All right, we started this also early this year. All right, we have 12 MOOCs offered in open learning. All right, again, we identify the lecturers who believe in this, work with them. All right, example, School of Bioscience. All right, School of Business. All right, School of this is Tourism. All right, School of Tourism, this is Engineering. All right, we identify all these lecturers, all right, and then to help us to become the ambassador also. We work with them, they give us the content, we design for them. All right, we give them the technical support, and we offer the courses online also. Right, and currently, we have about 11,000 students. All right, if 11,000 divided by 12 modules, each module is about, I think about slightly more than 1,000. Right, so it's not really massive, but it's also a direction that we are moving to, right? Direction we are moving to, because we like our lecturers to use this MOOC as the supplement to the traditional classroom teaching, all right? And then the lecturers will encourage their students to have some collaboration with online students also. So I'm going to have one assignment where online students need to collaborate with, right? Online students need to collaborate with the existing students to complete some assignments. Okay, all right. I move on to the questions to see whether you have any questions for me or not. So far I've shared with you about our lecture capture systems. We share with how we use Moodle, and also we share with you also our X-Space classrooms. All right. Any other things you'd like to make students power, I think make use of students power also. Right. Sometimes if we are not able to decide what subjects to be recorded, then we work with student council. You tell me what subjects you think is the most difficult one and you think will be you can learn better with these lecture capture systems. Why would students attend lectures if it's still available online later? Right. Students nowadays, they come to lectures, not only listen to you, they want to talk to their friends. They want their social life also, right? So if you put it online also, I don't think they like it. All right. So they still would prefer to come to lecture theatre to talk to their friends, right? To network with their friends also. Why isn't there a cordless mic? Yeah, we provide cordless mic also. I provide cordless mic. Yeah. We have handheld and also we have cordless also. Right. Depends on lecturer's preference. All right. Let me move on. I'll spend the next 10 minutes talk about the Anugrah. All right. This is my submission. Right. I get to know this AN only in 2012. Right. 2012 actually, I get the call from VC. All right, Dato Hassan to say, Chilong, would you want to try this AN? And I actually spent about, that time I actually spent about close to about 2 months to prepare the portfolio. All right, I never heard about this AN. And then I went to the seminar of AN. All right, then only I realized to submit this AN also, you cannot only submit one book. You need to submit a few books or so, your portfolio. Right, and then I tried and I was called for the interview, but I didn't get it that time. And this year, all right, my VC called me again and said, Chilong, because you are not allowed to apply every year, right? If last year you didn't get it, this year you can't apply. You need to wait for 1 year. All right, and then my Dato Hassan actually told me, Chilong, I think this year you should give yourself another chance or so. All right, then I submit a portfolio. All right, and I'm quite lucky this year. Right, I'm quite lucky this year to get it. And I would like to share with you my, these are some of my submissions. All right. The first part, I talk about the teaching philosophy. All right, teaching philosophy, and then I came up with something easy to remember. I call this as Hebat, but not really Hebat. All right. Hebat here is actually stands for holistic experience with blended learning approach using technologies. How I actually provide holistic learning experience to my students with the use of technology. All right. And I give example based on SHINE. SHINE stands for System for Holistic and Integrated E-Learning Strategy also. All right, so I develop a SHINE strategy, all right, to to show evidence what are the different types of e-learning activities. Right, all the different types of e-learning activities are implemented with the aim to minimize teaching, maximize learning. Right, to minimize teaching, maximize learning, because I believe less is more. Right, less is more. And the second part is also I'm quite active in sharing. Right, because a lot of things we are implementing at Taylor's now, we learn from someone. Right, we've learned from NTU. Right, learn from NUS. We even go to Australia to learn from them also. Right, so and then I think it's time for us to also share also. Right, we believe in sharing. Right, believe in sharing also, and I would prefer myself to be a guy on the side instead of the sage on the stage. Right, and I strongly believe that the role of the educators is to create the interactive learning environment for students. All right, where students are able to spark their own enthusiasm for learning. Right, there is no point for you to force them for learning, but our role is how to create the environment for them so that they are able to learn better, all right, to make learning more relevant to them and also learning fun to them also. All right, and to achieve this, I have a few examples of the innovations I've implemented. Some of these are very common. Also, some of these really very common. All right, number one is promote learning beyond the physical classrooms. Right. I use the web conferencing software. Right. Acculearn also has a web conferencing software. It's called AcuConference also. But I started this in 2008, all right, where we still use Blackboard, and under Blackboard there's one software called Illuminate. I'm not sure whether you heard before. Nah? So this is actually like a web conferencing, and I'm the first one actually started this e-learning day with my students. I'm going to have one day in a semester. You no need to come for my class. All of you just connected to this platform. Let's learn together, all right? So I actually teach them online. It's alive, and students can actually all over the place. Somebody says, sir, I just wake up, all right, at home, all right? So we actually have this web conferencing with them to conduct my lectures. All right, I try only a few rounds and then get their feedback. I also promote collaborative learning using online discussion forum. I believe this is something very common now, all right? Use discussion forums to have a group discussions, all right? To have some case study discussions among students, okay? Innovative assessment practices, right, to engage students with all these online learning activities, online quizzes, some interactive activities to enhance their learning experience. And also this is, I ask our students to produce a digital storytelling assignments. Right. So instead of you prepare a written assignment, explain the concept, now I don't want a written assignment, I want everything in a video. And the video must be only in 3 minutes, 5 minutes. Right, and then you submit a video to me, then I'm going to assess this. To use some infographic for presentation, right? E-portfolio, which I'm going to explain a little bit later, e-portfolio also, to use e-portfolio as a reflection. This X space to bring your own device into the classrooms, and also to have some personalized learning through all these apps also. Right, so these are some of the examples here, and I'm going to go into a little bit detail about these assignments. Right? These assignments, I call this as students-generated instructional video. Right? Like I mentioned to you, we throw away the traditional written assignments, produce a video. Let me show you one video.
The market segments to enter. This action is called market targeting.
Yes!
Inside this order is our talent market. Buyers are too many to differently their needs and buying behavior. So some agents have marketers focus on a particular group of consumers to sell their product. Oh yo! All these durians look so delicious, but if you do not do sanitation, you are like selling durian to Western countries. No matter how good is the durian, for them it just smells like salted fish or sheep.
All right. So these are the different videos that we actually ask our students to do, right? And that when iPhone 4 was introduced to Malaysia. So we asked them to do some videos about iPhone 4, and then we create a competition, actually a university-wide competition also. Ask them to explain about the benefits of all these gadgets, all right, and put in a video, and really give, we really receive very good feedback. And these are some philosophy behind also, all right. We want our students to actually able to, we want to create some curiosity among them also, all right, to explore different areas of presentation. All right, we want our students to do their own reflections also. Because to explain a concept is quite simple, but you want to explain a concept where the audience can understand. This is a tougher part. Right? And then we even ask them to upload their videos on YouTube and see how many likes you get. Marks will be given also. All right, we want them to actually introduce this to their friends, to ask their friends to watch, give comments also. Right? And we have a very clear expectation to them, marking rubrics to them. And they can actually use this as part of their e-portfolio also. So our students, they put all these things in their e-portfolio. I put this all this in e-portfolio. So this is my last part of presentation. E-portfolio for reflection. Right? We started e-portfolio in also 2009, right? Where we asked our students to do some reflections. And in 2010, we started asking our students, for those who go for the internship, to prepare their internship report using e-portfolio. So, and here are some of the examples. Here are some of the examples here. Okay. Let me see whether I'm able to share with you or not. I'm not able to share. I think, never mind. So these are some of the examples of e-portfolio. Right, where students actually do reflections on their internship journey. All right, students actually do some reflections in terms of the assignments they have done, what are the different skills they have acquired, and also they do some showcasing. This is a place for them to showcase their strength, and we tell them this is something like your resume, right? Like a resume, right? When you want to apply for a job, so you use this instead of traditional resume, all right. Yeah, so basically that's all about my sharing. I want to see whether there's any. This is one of the examples, yeah. So this is one of the examples. My students do some reflections online. So do reflection in terms of their internship, all right. What is the learning outcome of the internship? All right, what is the learning outcome of the internship? All right, what are the lessons they have learned? Right? What are the lessons they have learned? So they put everything here, right? And then the internship report also. Internship report also, they put it here also. So for us is at the end of the internship, we just need to receive a link from you, that's all. Right, need to just receive a link from you. Everything is inside. Right, everything is inside already. And they even do some reflections also. Right, do some reflections here also. All right. Their SWOT analysis, right. So this is a platform for them to do reflections also. The two common platforms, the first one is Google Sites, but I think since last year, we started asking our students to use this Wix, W-I-X, Wix or so. Right? We started asking our students to use Wix already. Let me see whether I'm able to show you this one. This is a Wix, it's more interactive. W-I-X is a free software also, it's a free software. So students do their own reflections here. They put up all their assignments. So my subjects, right, they need to put up all their assignments here. Right? So their projects. So they use this platform to submit all their assignments. So if I want to know their video assignments, I just click on the video assignments and everything is there. All right. And it's something not difficult to learn. All right. Do you know how do I teach my students how to use Wix or not? YouTube, yes, all right. I just need to provide them three links. All right, how to actually set up a site in Wix. YouTube, there are so many different videos to show to them. I think our role is to share with them. You can actually get all these resources online. You go and learn it. All right. So my task is I'm going to let you know about what are the reflections I want to see inside. All right. I'm not going to touch so much on the technical part. Because if I ask our lecturers to teach our students how to use this technical part, the lecturers are going to say, oh, Chi Leong, I don't know how to use the Wix, so I'm not able to use it. So we convince our lecturers by telling them, if you need any workshop, yes, the Teacher Learning Center will conduct workshop for your students, but it's actually not difficult to learn. Really not difficult to learn also. And students are able to learn all these things. And even students will tell you the new features also. Right, the new features also. Okay, all right. Yeah, and then there's a music inside also. So it actually make your life much more. Yeah, when you mark the assignment, so you are able to listen to music. Right, yeah. So the website is all come with music also. Let me see, any other questions for me or not? Oh, thanks for coming. Yeah.
Apart from Kellogg University, we should successfully encourage most of the lecturers using auto lecture capabilities. Do you know any other institutions?
Any other institutions? Malaysia?
Any other institution in Singapore or in Australia?
Yes, I think many of them are using it, but different platforms, right? UUM are using it also, but I heard also the not very successful. Number one is because of they need a lot of manual work by the lecturers also, and the connection is also not very strong. So even as a lecturer, I want to upload the video, so it takes so long. At the end, the lecturers are going to give up. I'm not going to use it, right? Yes, correct. NTU and US are using it. I read some research paper when we started this also. A lot of universities in US, right, according to our students, right, the students don't mind to pay, I think about 81% of the students, they don't mind to pay extra, all right, to enroll into the course with a lecture capture facility. And about 69% of the students, lecture capture is a main consideration when they want to take this elective course. So they see whether your elective got any lecture capture or not. If not, then I'm not going to take. Right? Mm-hmm. So a lot of universities are using it, right? But it's towards the extent. Right? Some of these are actually give flexibility. All right? You want to use it, use it. You don't want to use it, okay? Some actually make it automated, we call this as compulsory also. As long as you're assigned to these classrooms, you have to use it. Unless you're able to get permission from the dean to say not.
My next question would be the content in your Moodle.
Yeah.
I see that the content inside your Moodle are very impressive. Can you tell us how much is being created by your center and how much is being created by the lecturer themselves?
The content, I would say, of course, I share with you is some example of the good content. All right, some example of good content, and most of the content actually is collaboration between my center and also the lecturers. The lecturers themselves, their involvement is only to provide content only. To provide content, and we'll do some magic for them. Now we do some magic for them. Right? To. Yes.
I have three issues.
Yeah.
Number one is about the support system.
Sorry.
Support system.
Support systems. Yeah. Okay.
Because if I'm right, Davis University, you do provide technical support, right? In terms of preparing the content. I think the challenge in USM is I don't think we have that specific support system at the school level or at the university level. So the challenge is for the lecturer, normally they will prepare the e-content materials themselves. So I think the good thing we learned, I think from Dallas, is you have a dedicated team. And I think the same experience when I visited Cardiff University last time, when they have this dedicated team to provide the e-learning content material. I think if the USM can provide, although they are providing now, whereby in terms of video lecturing, there are a dedicated team to video record the lectures. But I think the support should be more extensive to the level of preparing the e-learning material, the e-learning content material. All right. So this number one, I think the support system is very important. I think so many lecturers are so eager to go into this kind of e-learning environment, but preparing the content is one thing, it's a big challenge. If the support system is good like Dallas, I think more lecturers will embrace this kind of culture. That's about the support system. And number two is about the, you have talked about so much about collaborative learning. One example you use just now is the flipped classroom and everything. So my question is, but what about the assessment? But at the end of the day, when you teach students, right, you somehow you try to assess their understanding, their connective aspect. So you haven't, as far as my understanding, you haven't touched any on the assessment. So my question is, do you put element of collaboration also into the assessment part? For example, when you have the tutorial, right? So do you assess the student during that period? Or if not, where are the time you assess other than the traditional way of examination? And what does that mean? Maybe if you want to answer anyone first before I go to the second issue.
Okay, right. The first part you actually asked about the extensive support team. We don't really, because our team is also not a very big team, right? We give support to lecturers for those who like to play the game with us first. Right? The more important is the school need to commit that, okay, all right, I would like 30% of the content, all right, to be converted into E. Then only we are going to work with the school. Right, so we actually work the school by school programs by programs also. So example, let's say School of Accounting. All right, there are so many programs, you are not able to support all the lecturers also. So we are going to get the deans to identify under this school, this program, all right, please work with these 10 lecturers only. Right, so we are going to work with, our support is very focused. Someone is very focused. We just focus on these 10 lecturers. And we want these 10 lecturers to be our ambassador. Right? So this is number one, the support. And again, to create content is very time consuming. All right, we are not really able to provide the content, the support to all of them also. And also, one of the lessons we learn is we spend so much time with lectures A, develop content, then at the end of the, maybe the next year, the lectures are, this content is no longer relevant really. All right, so that's why we always encourage the lecturers, use lecture capture. Use lecture capture because lecture capture is the easiest way to create a content. All right, and I'm not going to say the lecture capture content is lousy because it's my own teaching, right? All right. This is number one. And number two, talk about the assessments. In the collaborative learning, we have some learning outcomes achieved also. So example for my class, I need my students to, let's say, present a case study, right? The findings of a case study. So before I end my class, I need to make sure the case studies questions are addressed and are discussed. So this is how I actually evaluate them. And another example is, let's say, I'm going to teach them about e-portfolio. Right? At the end of the class, I'm going to see whether they are able to come with e-portfolio site for me or not. Right? So this is how we actually measure the outcomes. Right? So every lessons there must be a outcomes to achieve. Right? Outcomes to achieve, and the outcomes must be demonstrated by the students. Right?
Examination still there.
Sorry? Examination, yes. Examinations within 50% still will be final exam. Still a final exam. And we also advise our lecturers to relate their class activities to their assessments also. Example, I do one like I'm actively using online quiz in my class. All right, every day I also give students online quizzes to practice. But at the end, final exam about case study. So you know, so whatever students learn in the class, they are not able to apply in the final exam. So and then you're going to tell them, come in, Chi Leong, this model is lousy. I'm the most active lecturers. By the end, my students' results is dropped. Right, because you must relate your assessments to the activities that you conduct in the classrooms also.
Okay, the third one is about the statistics just now.
Mm-hmm.
But you have shown the statistics, I think I really believe that. Because you want to show something, you need the data. Okay, the question is the statistics just now. The thing is, do you only capture the data from the Moodle or other public platform? Because like USM, USM also have done this kind of statistics also. But at the moment, the statistics is based only on the Moodle platform, the e-learn and USM. So my question is, are you only focusing on the Moodle platform only, or other platform as well, in
coming out with that? At this moment, we only focus on Moodle only, because this is our official e-learning platform, right? And we also focus on, we also provide support focusing on Moodle also. So if, let's say, a school would like to use some other platform apart from Moodle, we'll say, at this moment, sorry, because this is our official one, we like you to actually, the university has invested a lot in this platform, so I would like to actually bring all the traffic to this platform, right? Okay.
Some questions.
Some questions? What is your infra like in infra? Of course, before we started this also in 2011, we spent about a year to upgrade the infra before we implementing all these e-learning activities also. Right. But of course, I think compared to USM, our infra is not as good as USM, I believe so. Right. We only have about 500 access points. I believe USM more than access points. The only thing we want to focus on is we want to make sure if, let's say, a student or lecturers, if you are accessing rewind, lecture capture in the campus, we need to make sure the speed must be good enough for them. All right, we want to make sure this is so. If you want to download the video also, you need to spend about, right? So we focus, the infra part, we focus on our core services. Right, focus on core services, which is Moodle, and also our lecture capture. Right, Wi-Fi coverage, yeah. I think our bandwidth now is about 600 megabits per second. 600 megabits per second. And of course, the ICT department will tell you, all right, 600 is actually the best services we are able to provide. But we are going to open up the pipe for lecture capture. Is this a pipe? Right? YouTube, is this a pipe? Right? So you're going to open up based on the request also. Based on request and based on the priority of the universities. Right? We encourage you to do different types of activities, but we focus on selected core services to provide you the support. Any other questions? Suitable for technical course involving special equipment or not? I would say not, no, because not all the nature of the course, not all are suitable for e-learning. This is something that we really need to admit also. And we focus on the schools that are willing to, again, I always say, want to play the games with us lah. All right, certain schools, they say, okay, cannot, all right. These very technical things, all right, and then my students need to do, especially the kitchen operations, all this. No, not all the, not all are relevant, not all are relevant. Yes?
Profile of the students come to Taylor's.
How do I define the profile? I would say number one is more than 95% of students with device. Yeah, they come with device, so there is no issue in terms of bring your own device concept. All right. Our students, they are very tech savvy. I would say the background are very similar. All right. I would say number one is they have a very short attention span. I think all of us, you know. Right. So you need to use technology to engage them. Right. Number two, they are very tech savvy. All right. They want attention. Right. How to capture attention, we are using all this, let them voice out, right? And also they are afraid to make mistakes. They're really afraid to make mistakes. Right? But if you put them in the group, let them discuss as a group, then they are all right. They are all right. So even they make mistakes, also they say, okay, right, this is not my mistake, it's my whole group mistakes. Right? They will laugh together. Right? So I think the profile, I think we're very similar. And then in terms of, if you're talking about the financial, I think they are, I think compared to the
public university
students, they pay a very high fee also.
See, from what I heard from your lecture, sorry to say this, but every step the lecturer takes, every step the student takes is all dollars and cents. You know what I mean? It's all money. So as far as public university is concerned, I think it will be a longer time. You know, I pray to God that all public universities will be like Taylor's one day. Prof. Hassan was the deputy vice chancellor here. He's a chancellor, he knows, you know, he told me the stories, number one. And we had someone in this group just now, one person is there from above. So someone must come to Taylor's, now must make sure that he or she has all this. That's why I asked the profile, that he or she must have the dollars, fine. Number two, with all these budgets, otherwise he's going to fail. And it's actually a very elitist kind of thing, because now we're depriving many children from Felda, from the estates, you know, to come to a place like this to get this facilities. It's very, very sad. That is my concern, my passion. You know, coming back to my passion, that's my passion, you know. My passion is to share, you know, to those who need them. There are many classrooms don't need students, don't need teachers. You know, they can pass. But we want to go to the ones that, you know, they really need. So while you're talking, I was thinking of the schools that I go to,
villages that I go to, I'm still going, I cannot communicate. The other thing is, I would like, can you show me your philosophy, please?
Correct your slide, your philosophy.
Let me add one more thing. I think our students in our private universities are very demanding also. They're really very demanding. All right? They will compare, say, why why my friends in another school, they have this lecture capture, why you don't have this lecture capture in my school? All right? So this is how we are able to drive. We use students' power to drive. Yes, because they pay, yes. Are you referring to this one?
Yes.
Teach less,
learn more. Teach less, learn more. Example, I want to teach a subject. That's why I'm okay. Maybe I quote example.
Okay, never mind. Which means, do you spend less time for preparation when you say teach less?
More time for preparation, but less time in the classroom to teach them. Example, I want to teach them about weeks. Yeah. I've been teaching weeks for, I think this is the third round, I'm teaching weeks already, and I don't want to repeat the same thing. All right, so what I do is I provide the content, right? I provide the content to my content development team, ask them to come up with a learning object for me. So I upload the whole thing here for students. So what students need to do is, if you want to learn about Wix, please come here. First is I share with you about what is ePortfolio. I share with you about different example of ePortfolio from your seniors. All right, and then these are some of the steps you need to follow. All right, so I guide them step by step. Step one, all right, what need to do? Step two, what need to do? So I guide them step by step. So in the classroom, I no longer need to teach them about Wix already. I teach less in the classrooms, all right? But the students are able to learn more with these learning objects. And I'm able to also see whether they learn or not. At the end also, I'm going to ask them, okay, all right, you have learned everything. Let's do a quiz now. All right, let's do a quiz now to see whether you understand or not. And then submit. Wrong, or you see? All right, So in terms of preparation, I think it's more time, spend more time for preparation, but not in the classrooms.
Right. And finally, I think, you know, public universities, we don't actually focus 100% on teaching and learning. You have so many other baskets to fulfill. So in a situation like that, you know, preparation takes a lot of time. Although Dr. Rahan will say, you know, look at half glass, you know. The reality is, you have sometimes to be the other part of it. Yes, Wadi, finally, congratulations to both of you. Well deserved.
Mr. Lin, can I just respond to Prof? Prof, can I just say something? I think I'm very inspired by what Mr. Lin is doing. I'm not of that caliber at all, but I'm very inspired. And I agree with you that, you know, we are kind of creating a bit of an elitist kind of a society within our society. But having said that, though, this is my philosophy of the glass being half full. You know, what I mean by that is, I'm always trying to see the positive side of this kind of a development. So on the one hand, we can say, well, you're creating a bit of a gap between the haves and the have-nots. I agree with that. I completely agree with that. But having said that, if we don't have that in our society, we're going to cause brain drain. We're going to cause these kids who are brilliant at what they do and not provide them the space to do it to go outside of it. Why do that? If certain institutions can provide, so be it. UKM can't yet, we're not there yet. It's the same case with the public universities. But just because we can't and other people can, we shouldn't celebrate that. So my take is, I wish I was working in an institution like that. So Prof. Karim's take for me just now was, no, you aspire for that, and I agree. We all aspire, and if your passion is to work on the grassroots level, so be it. And I think we can all do a little bit. You know, whatever we're passionate about, and you can see Lim was super passionate, you know? And I'm like, gosh, I'm taking down Wix.com, okay? Because I don't know all these gadgets, you know? And Prof. Karim told me, well, you gotta learn. I said, yeah, I will keep learning, but I know I'm the tortoise. I'm constantly going slow and steady, but my passion is elsewhere. But that's okay, but I like the fact that Taylor has this. You know, it shows me that, okay, this is something Malaysia can aspire for. Do you know what I mean? So at least the gap is not between our country and another country. Rather, we brought it into the country. So I think that helps.
Well, in one sentence, you know, if you ask me, I wish Malaysia was still an agricultural country and not industrialized. Because I could be moved for my food now, you know.
Right.
Papaya cost me ringgit 20 cents before.
Any other questions? Maybe one little thing, let me write up the whole sessions. I share with you different types of innovations, right? About in reality, not all the lectures actually make use of all these innovations. All right, we believe that we are actually providing you like a buffet style. All right, there are so many different innovations, and we just hope that you pick up one innovation and try in your class only. Right, so some lectures say, okay, so many things, let me try only online quiz in my class only. All right, let me try to convert some of my assessment into E. Right, some lectures pick up the blogging part. Right, so whatever I share with you just now is actually a combination of all these small little things that the lectures have done. Mm-hmm. Yes, Prof.
The reason I congratulate both of you just now, one for Dr. Ayer for the passion that I love so much, and of course for you for the IT, and the other thing which I is also my dream, I really wish that as Malaysians, this from the bottom of my heart, that this session could be the Malay language, could be also developed the Malay language. Thank you.
Okay, alright, thanks Prof.
Today we'll wrap up the session. Thank you, Mr. Lim, for a very interactive session.